Thank you. Today, we celebrate the life of Stephen Bullenbach Belanger, or Belanger, a name that comes from the Normandy region of France with its prefix Bel, meaning beautiful. And Stephen's life was beautiful. Une belle vie. From the sublime skies of the Oklahoma panhandle to the sweet strumming of a guitar, from Scottish highlands to Spanish beaches to the serenades of songbirds, beauty was woven throughout his life. And beauty wasn't only there in places and things. It was especially there in his relationships with other people, in his undying love for his daughters, his sons-in-law, and his sweet baby granddaughter, in the friendships he maintained over time and distance, in joyous times spent with family, graced with music and good food, and of course, and his great and tender love for Claudia. Now, I must tell you that there's another possible source of the name Belanger, and that is from the old French, Belanger, meaning one who fights with a spear. Now, for many of us, it's hard to equate the idea of a warrior with a sweet and quiet spirit that was Stephen. And yet, he was also a fighter in his own way. He modeled with his own life the values of justice, freedom, faithfulness to country, to land, to the birds, and especially to the people he loved. One does not maintain the friendships and family ties that Stephen did without being willing to fight for them. And even at the end, he faced disease and death itself with courage, like a peaceful warrior. Our service today is an opportunity to celebrate Stephen's beautiful, courageous life. It is also a time to mourn his physical absence, to let cleansing tears come, to allow the body and the mind to grieve. And it is a time to rejoice in the presence of one another and to make space for healing laughter. Amid our busy, worried lives, the death of a loved one opens a space for quiet introspection. And so today, as you listen to the story of Stephen's life, I hope you'll pause to think about how his life touched yours personally. Think about what you learned from him and what you can carry into your own words and actions. And I invite you to think about your own life. Where is the beauty in your life? And for what are you willing to fight? What is the through line in your story? Who has loved you into being? Whom do you love? And have you told them recently just what they mean to you? As our opening reading today, I'd like to share with you this poem by Robert Service called Bird Sanctuary. It's a poem that Stephen knew well. Between the cliff rise and the beach, a slip of emerald I own, with fig and olive, almond, peach, cherry, and plum tree overgrown. glad watered by a crystal spring that carols through the silver night, and populous with birds who sing gay madrigals for my delight. Some merchants fain would buy my land to build a stately pleasure dome. Poor fools. They cannot understand how precisely it is my home. So luminous with living wings, so musical with feathered joy, not for all pleasure fortune brings would I such ecstasy destroy. 1,000 birds are in my grove, melodious from morn to night. My fruit trees are their treasure trove. Their happiness is my delight. And through the sweet and shining days, they know their lover and their friend. So I will shield in peace and praise my innocence unto the end. Now please rise in body or in spirit as we sing hymn number 318. It's in the gray hardbound hymnal, We Would Be One. Please be seated. I'm honored to read the obituary that was provided by Stephen's family. Stephen Bullenbach Belanger died peacefully on July 11th, 2022, of complications resulting from cancer of the prostate. He lived his final hours as he had lived his life, with courage and grace, surrounded by family, friends, and music. Stephen was born in Kingfisher, Oklahoma on December 17, 1945, to Leon and Aline Belanger, the youngest of three children. He was raised in Guymon, Oklahoma, where his father worked for Skelly Oil Company and his mother taught school and served as an organist for the Presbyterian Church. After graduating from the University of Oklahoma, where he majored in zoology, Stephen joined the Air Force, and he served for 3 years at the Lake and Heath, England Air Force Base. Now, back in the U.S., Stephen found work as a well tester. And his work took him across Oklahoma, and he used those long drives to memorize poetry, including a few of the poems of Robert Service, known as the Bard of the Yukon. That would be the one in Canada, not Oklahoma. Claudia tells me that these poems were well suited to Stephen's deep bass voice, and hearing him recite them was a treat. Stephen married Jean Schwartz, and they had two daughters, Katie and Margot. Nothing could come in the way of his great love and active devotion for these two. Not divorce, time, space, not even death. He found ways to support them and maintain connection across the miles. And after the energy company that he was working for shut down, Stephen found work at the Sutton Avian Research Center in Bartlesville. And even living there for a time in the old chick lab so he could provide for his girls. Days found him serving as what the family would later lovingly refer to as the quail wrangler. And evenings would find him practicing guitar for the birds up on that lonely hill. Working with kindred spirits at Sutton, Stephen became an avid and expert birder, though he was modest about his skills. He kept a handwritten birding diary, and he added to his life list every chance he got. The daily visitors to his feeders and his bird bath brought him great joy. Now, many of you will remember his time serving this congregation as custodian, quietly working his crossword puzzles during his lunch breaks, and otherwise going about his tasks. Stephen was a quiet soul, but when he spoke, it was with a twinkle in his eye and wit. He regarded his life as fortunate and blessed, never more so than in seeing his daughters married to men whom he quickly thought of as sons, and at the arrival of a granddaughter in 2021. The highlight of each year for Stephen and Claudia was when the kids would come for Thanksgiving and their quiet house became joyously raucous. Cousins from Bartlesville would drive over and everyone would cook and visit and play music. And there would be the glorious feast at Brother Mike's house. And there would be more music on the deck. Everyone would raise a glass and play cards, and last year there was a new baby. And it was always over, all too soon. Stephen's life with us, his community, his friends, his family, was also over all too soon. He leaves behind Claudia Cochran, daughter Katie Belanger, and her husband, John Ketterhagen, daughter Margot, and her husband, Nicholas Rossi, granddaughter, Louisa Rossi, and brother, Michael Belanger. He was preceded in death by his parents and a sister, Ann Belanger Durney, and he will be missed deeply by all who knew him. And we will cherish every memory. At this point, we will hear some remembrances from those who knew Stephen best, beginning with his brother, Mike.
Good Stephen Bolenbach Belanger. I'm proud he was my brother, he was my partner, and he was my friend. I can't begin to tell you all about him in the time we have today. And I'm not going to begin to try that. But I can tell you a little bit about him. Stephen loved life. He loved the outdoors and all of the animals. He became an avid bird watcher. To our mother's dismay, he kept a king snake as a pet for several years. It makes sense that he majored in zoology at OU. We grew up in Guymon. In the summers, that meant the municipal swimming pool, where Stephen had a season pass every year from the time he was 6 years old. And he never missed a day. There was no swimming or diving coach in Guymon, but Stephen taught himself diving and became a very good diver on his own. In fact, when he came to OU, which still had a swimming and diving team, he walked on as a diver and competed for the university. I was reminded of his diving prowess about 3 years ago when I was working on a project with a Guymon alum several grades ahead of me, and he told his sister that we were working together. The next time I saw him, he told me that his sister had raved about what a great diver I was and how good looking I was. And I had to say, you've got the wrong Belanger. That was Stephen. Age and paper. Stephen was a gentle soul, as the Reverend said, but he didn't back off from competition. At OU, he participated in intramural competitions for his fraternity in various sports. He loved to tell the time about when he beat a two-time NCAA wrestling champion, Greg Ruth, in diving. Stephen loved music. The music from the record player in our room played everything from Buddy Holly to Louis Armstrong. We went to see the Kingston Trio together when I was at OU and he came down to visit, and that started his interest in folk music that lasted his lifetime. He learned to play the guitar, began singing, and with two of his friends, who had very good pitch, formed a folk trio that was known throughout the greater Guymon area as the Norfolk Trio. After graduation, he joined the Air Force during the Vietnam War. While stationed in England, he competed in the Air Force on the Air Force wrestling team for England, where he didn't beat any national champions, but he helped his team win the intra-service meet in Europe. He explored Europe, learned to ski in the Alps, attempted to run the bulls in Pamplona. He didn't realize that you had to register ahead of time. He thought you could just go down and join in the run. When Bob Hope's Christmas tour came to his Air Force base, he was the escort for Ursula Andress. And he did such a good job that he had to do it the next year. When he finished his service, he returned to Guymon. He bought a horse and, after some planning, set out on horseback from the Oklahoma Panhandle through the New Mexico Plains and the Pecos Wilderness to Santa Fe. That adventure took months, and the picture of him in front of the La Fonda Hotel in Santa Fe made the first page of the Santa Fe paper. Stephen was one of the best fathers I have ever seen, and while he doted on his girls, as an old sailor, he kept them on an even keel. They are marvelous young women, and he was a part of that. He was over the moon when his granddaughter Louisa was born, and he made the most of the time that he had with her. Stephen and Claudia started dating about 20 years ago, and they never quit. He loves Claudia dearly. Every year they went to Winfield to the folk festival. They loved the campfires and making music with their friends. They followed local musicians and were regulars for their favorite. Music making with friends continued in the boathouse bar that he made. It contains one of his pieces of art that he created. It's a 5-foot-long fish with colorful scales that were made from metal from beer cans and secured in the proper position for scales. He favored Bud Light cans for the task because of the colors. We spent a lot of time together and were partners, and I cannot remember us ever having a cross word. He was strong, and I don't know if he was ever rattled. Even when he was hanging from a tree in a rushing flood at night, waiting for his friend Jerry Martin to bring a boat to rescue him, or when he and Charlie Vestal were sailing their 24-foot sailboat in a tropical storm, 10-foot-high waves in the Sea of Cortez. When he realized in the hospital that he was paralyzed, in true Stephen fashion, he said that he felt like he was standing with Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid on that cliff where you look over at the river. It's so far below that the fall would kill you. And he told me, "I'm ready to jump." He was ready even if we were not. He was a really good man, and we will all miss him. And I will always picture him with Butch and Sundance.
Nothing gold can stay. And if you knew him, you know that Stephen was a golden son and fun-loving, generous, beautiful, talented, loyal, and loving soul. When I think of Stephen, I think of him in the sun. He had some Louisiana Cajun from his father's side, and he identified with that easy way of life. From his red wine right down to his skin, which turned nut brown in the summer. Before he became ill, he loved to mow the yard, stripped down to cutoffs, an unlit cigar between his teeth. Once I was in the home office when I heard a deep voice over the drone of the mower. He was practicing one of his Robert Service poems he had memorized. And then I knew why he didn't find mowing monotonous. Dangerous Dan McGrew and Athabasca Dick were keeping him manly company. I remember our first trip together. We were on the beach in San Diego, and he had bought a little styrofoam boogie board. He was quite the sight at 60 years old among all the kids on the beach. Yeah, he still had it. At the end of the trip, he noticed a family with two little girls on the beach. "Would you like to have this board?" he said. "I can't take it back on the plane with me." I'm sure the delighted children reminded him of his own girls. Stephen was a natural artist with an artist's mind. This took some getting used to for me, as I tend to be analytical. During our time together, I like to think he softened some of my sharper edges, and maybe I spurred him on a little bit too. I was Ravenclaw to his Gryffindor, and I learned to trust his intuition as just as valuable as my tendency to plan. He was happiest out of doors, and when any kind of weather came in, he had to step outside to check it out. Maybe that came from growing up in the panhandle, but watching the weather on TV, he was restless until he could open the door and sniff the air, feel the rain, see the clouds breaking. One winter, when we'd lost electricity for a few days, I had to stop him from standing in the open doorway looking outside. Stephen was the most non-judgmental person I ever met. If he heard negative gossip about someone, he'd maybe shake his head and say, "Well, I don't know," leaving others to dish the actual dirt. He cultivated his cherished friendships and maintained ties with men who had shared his boyhood. In most company, he was content to listen, but when his old pals got together, he was in the thick of the stories, and I never heard him laugh so freely. The other time he was most at ease was with his girls, Katie and Margot. You know how very much he loved you and how proud you made him. He absolutely lived for Tuesday and Thursday 4 p.m. phone calls when you would conference in and read books aloud together. I heard a few of them, and Katie, you could have a new career as a professional narrator, I am sure. Margot, your calls at night to let him sing the Cajun lullaby Gay Gay to baby Louisa were so precious to him as their memory is to me. You will both never regret the time you took away from your busy lives in Wisconsin to share that dad time with him. He was usually quiet, but had a dry wit that would catch you up when you least expected it. Some of you have heard this story, but I like to remember when we first moved back to Oklahoma City from KC. He was driving and I was navigating. We were coming up on the star intersection at Western and Grand, you know the one. I said, "And now you're going to make the sharpest left turn you've ever made in your life." Not missing a beat, he replied, "I don't know, I voted for Obama, you know." Stephen and I were blessed to have met, to be so well suited, and to have 17 years together. It wasn't long enough, but I know he will remain with me for the rest of my own life, be it short or long. How I found someone so kind, pure of heart, I'll never know. I even used to call him my Boy Scout. He was so guileless. We each thought we'd got the better deal, and maybe that was our secret. But I know now with absolute certainty that I got the better deal with my Stephen, who never stopped loving us all as he loved the world around him. Nothing gold can stay, and Stephen was solid gold.
Have some music now from John Ketterhagen, the son-in-law.
Thank you.
And Katie and Margot like to say some words.
Hello, we are Katie and Margot Belanger, Steve's daughters, and we would like to thank you all for coming out today to honor our dad. We know some of you have traveled a long distance to come pay your respects, and for that we're truly grateful. Our dad was genuinely the best person we've ever known.
There's no way to tell every story or memory we love of him, because it was honestly everything in his being. As simple as seeing him first thing in the morning when all was calm and quiet, sitting there in his chair with his coffee and a crossword. I don't know if we ever spoke this out loud, but I think we both secretly tried to beat each other in being the first one awake so we would get that special morning time with him all to ourselves, at least for a little while. Because one of our dad's greatest abilities was to make you feel special and important. Whether that was watching a movie solely because you recommended it, sending a text during an OU touchdown, or taking a photo of something he knew you'd like to show you. Even now, he has been reminding us of how special he found us when we discover grade school art projects, rocks we gave him in childhood, and cards we sent over the years, all tucked away in his treasured possessions. For our part, we always knew how special it was that we had him, that we were the chosen ones who got to call him dad. We were seriously the envy of every kid at Reeves Park in Norman, Oklahoma, as he chased us through the maze of playground equipment, making up tag games that caused the other kids to try to join our little party of three. He played his favorite CDs, like the Neville Brothers' Yellow Moon, and let us dance on the table. And he brought old cow bones home and buried them loosely in the yard when we wanted to be paleontologists so that we could discover them in the morning with our old toothbrushes. Almost everything had an educational twist to it with him. He famously couldn't start his car without us answering a multiplication question or supplying the definition to a vocab word. He took us to the zoo so much that when we went on guided tours, the staff joked that we could have their jobs with all our animal knowledge. The ultimate, though, was when we went to visit our maternal grandparents in Texas for the summer. To help them keep three rowdy kids entertained, he organized a scavenger hunt for us that involved solving various lessons from school textbooks that, once finished, were handed to our grandma in exchange for a clue to a hiding place with the next textbook riddle, eventually culminating into the grand prize of a rainbow-striped box filled with treasures, and of course, a Barnes & Noble gift card for more books. To this day, we have yet to meet another dad with the same drive for educating his children through fun and play. He encouraged so much of what and who we are now. Our love of learning, our love of reading, our love of the arts, in which he showed by example that you don't have to be great at something to do it. You just have to love it. So many of our birthday and Christmas cards were hand-painted watercolors with inscriptions like, "My lion didn't turn out too well, so you get a blue palm tree instead." He was goofy, he was fun, he was kind, and he was gentle. But most of all, he was our dad, and that was always enough.
Mm-hmm. We have a moment now if there is anyone else who would like to come to the lectern and share some thoughts.
I'm Bob Hurst, friend of Stephen's. I can't remember when I first met him, but he was a quiet, unassuming man and interesting. He always had interesting things to say. And although our initial meeting was probably through Claudia for a while, he and I developed our own friendship. Probably revolved around music and OU football. But Stephen would always call me when my Auburn Tigers won a big game. And I really appreciated that. We took a number of trips together, the four of us, my wife Patty, Claudia, Stephen, and I. And I remember one, we went down to Lake Hugo and took a cabin there and had a relaxed weekend of playing cards and Stephen fishing and Patty looking at clouds and finding dachshunds there. And we decided that the next year we wanted to see the Perseid meteor shower. So since it gets cloudy here in Oklahoma, we decided, hey, let's go out in the panhandle because it's always dry out there. So Claudia found Hoot Owl Ranch, which was a lovely spot. We went out there and turned dark and we went outside to look at meteors and we actually saw like one or two. And then the stars began to wink out one by one as the clouds came. And then the rain, and I complained, but Stephen never did. That was Stephen, he hardly ever complained. So it was an evening of playing music and playing cards. The next year we decided we'd try this again and we'd go to Altus down to Quartz Mountain. And so we took a room there at the lodge and dark came and we started to watch for meteors in this cloud bank on the western horizon where the meteors were supposed to come from, and we didn't see any. It started to rain. Stephen said, okay, more cards, more music, what can I ask for? So we had a lot of good times like those, and I remember when Stephen got the diagnosis that every man fears, and that's advanced prostate cancer, but he took it in stride. I never really heard him complain. He was not a stoic, because he was very straightforward about what he could and could not do. But he just never complained, not even when the clouds came and I was complaining about the unfairness of it all. So one of the things that I particularly remember about Stephen was he knew all these Robert Service poems. I mean, these things are long. And so I can hear his voice. There are strange things done in the midnight sun by the men who moil for gold. The Arctic trails have their secret tales that would make your blood run cold. The northern lights have seen queer sights, but the queerest they ever did see was the night on the marge of Lake LaBarge, I cremated Sam McGee. Stephen, I'm gonna miss you.
Pause for a moment of silence while we hold all of these stories, all of these truths in our hearts. Please join me in a spirit of prayer. Spirit of life, source of love, we gather our hearts today in grief and in gratitude. We grieve the absence of one who brought such quiet joy into the world, even as we are grateful that our time on this planet overlapped, at least for a while, with his. May we be reminded to live in a way that honors what was best of this man, with grace and dignity, with gentle humor, with loyalty, with attentiveness to the beauty all around us, including the presence of birds, and always with a song on our lips and in our hearts. Our community gathers on this day not only to celebrate Stephen, but to support those he leaves behind, those who have loved him the most, whose hearts are broken today. Today we hold in a cloud of love Mike, Bill, Abby, Katie, Margot, John, Nick, Louisa, our dear Claudia. We also extend our love to Stephen's many dear friends and family who will miss him so much. May Stephen's memory be a blessing to them all, to last throughout their lives. May we bond together as a community, connected by love, to hold each other up, to extend care and concern to those who need it most. May it be so. Amen. Once again, I invite you to rise in body or in spirit, to sing the hymn. The words are printed in your order of service. I'll fly away.
Thank you.
Please be seated. At the end of today's service, after the benediction, I will invite Stephen's family to leave the sanctuary as the rest of the congregation remains through the postlude. There will be a reception in Daniel Hall, which is just down the hall, through these doors and down the hall to your right, to which all are warmly invited. In his essay, The Judgment of the Birds, naturalist Lauren Isley recalls the time when he witnessed a raven that had killed and eaten a baby bird. All of a sudden, a soft sound of complaint began to rise in the glade, which came from countless small birds of many different varieties, drawn by the anguished cries of the nestlings' parents. The birds cried together in an instinctive common misery. But after a time, Isley writes, quote, "The crystal note of a song sparrow lifted hesitantly in the hush. And finally, after another painful fluttering, another took the song, and then another, the song passing from one bird to another, till suddenly they took heart and sang from many throats joyously, as birds are known to sing. They sang because life is sweet and sunlight beautiful. They sang under the brooding shadow of the raven. In simple truth, they had forgotten the raven, for they were the singers of life, not of death." Unquote. And now, may all of us gathered here today be like those birds. May we pass the song from one person to another. May we be the singers of life, because life is sweet and sunlight is beautiful. May it be so.